Good morning, and welcome to Health Talk here on AM 1270 and 96.5 FM KXPX. Bill Carney with me today in the studio. I'm Paul Thomas, and welcome to our first program of April. We got a phone call coming in here on a dedicated separate line. Welcome, Bill. How are things with you? Great Easter weekend.
Just tired of the age, you never know if you're going to not find one and you find it.
15 years, and under federal law, these wholesalers, Amasuerus, Macassan, and Cardinal, the middlemen who move drugs from manufacturers to dispensaries, are required to notify the DEA when they see unusual amounts of patterns of frequency of drug shipments. So, the Washington Post, which is part of the New York Times, and other media outlets have reported that some companies failed to do that. And allowing their pills to find a way into dealers and propelling the epidemic that nearly killed 64,000 people in 2016. And that's the most recent year. I'm sure 2017 was even worse. The Washington Post reported that at the height of the crisis, the DEA slowed its enforcement efforts and saw its work undermined by laws passed by Congress. And a breakdown of the actions went immediately available, but as in the past we've heard and have been told that they were going strictly after the pharmacists, not the physicians. It was our knowledge from the DEA that these things would be these enforcements would be to the pharmacists, because the pharmacist was the last person to prohibit getting that medication to the patient. So we have taken on many of those Schedule 2, 3, 4s, and 5s from the pharmacy that lost their license. And we have a documentation for opioid prescriptions, which was is quite detailed, and what the DEA says that we need to do to further investigate why a patient is getting this. And it starts out with, does the prescription appear to be legal, and then we put yes or no as prior authorization required by the insurance, yes or no is the prescription for acute or chronic pain, and we have to determine that by us. Does the patient have a pain control contract? And that's something else we must ask you. If yes, is the current prescription from the pain provider? And then did you run a Department of Justice report on this individual when they got a prescription? And we do everybody that has a controlled substance. So that report actually shows us if you've gotten a prescription someplace else in the state of California. And what date that was, what quantity it was, what doctor that was. And if you're trying to go to another pharmacy to get it, it shows up. You will have one of our requests so that you transfer all your prescriptions from that pharmacy to us. And that is because the Drug Enforcement Agency and the Board of Pharmacy does not want you going to other pharmacies because it becomes more difficult for them to track you. And we do not want to be a source just of pain medications to these patients. If it's prescribed, is it potentially dangerous at the weight they have, and we have to determine the morphine milligram equivalent of that drug, whether it's Narcan, whether it's oxycodone, whether it's Percocet. And then if you're getting a benzodiazepine, which is Xanax, or Ativan, or Tamazepam, or any of those drugs with it, we have to note that also. And then, whether or not you're getting it for end-of-life care, you can see how detailed this is, and I do this every day. Every prescription that comes in the door comes to me. That's a controlled substance, and I have to run these reports along with some of my staff. And I make the decision on whether or not we should fill it or whether we should consult you on the fact that there is a danger of you overdosing. Would you like to have Narcan, which is a reversal of opiate effects? If you say you would like to have Narcan, pharmacist does for Narcan explain you how to fill it, to use it, and then we explain to you that what it does, and you should inform your family or people that you live with in case you are unconscious, how they can give you the Narcan or law enforcement can. Also to bring you back. So that's why it's so difficult, and that's why many of our customers that are having a longer wait than they normally would have to, because we're bringing a lot of new prescriptions in. But always talk to us and tell us, you know, call a refill in at least 24 hours ahead of time, and you're not going to get your controlled two substance or things that influence the expiration date. Most of them expire after 2 to 3 years. And the registration date can be set by the manufacturers themselves, and then can be led to more discarded items than is necessary. So, if in fact they have a short expiration date, this means they're going to sell more product, and whether or not you need that product is not exactly determinable or not, but you can extend those expiration dates. It's true that you can extend them about a year beyond the date without any harm to your health or exposure to toxicity. In fact, there's no reported cases in the medical literature taking linking toxicity or harm to patients from expired medications. What I tell a patient to do is look at it. If it's deteriorated in appearance, it probably isn't effective anymore. And that's the main thing that you will see with the tablet starting to crumble with a lot of the vitamin C products and aspirin products will start smelling like acetic acid. When I was in the military, those 50 years ago, overseas, I worked in a hospital as a pharmacist, and every day we would get a report on extending the expiration date of mainly antibiotics, which would seem a little bit unusual because they are really important to people, and it's important for them to have the most effective time as far as efficacy goes when it gets into your system. But the prescription given to you by a doctor, you might want to inquire about the shelf life past that expiration date, as well as proper storage measures. And again, they're looking at this expiration date as if it was sitting in the pharmacy at an ideal temperature filling up, and there's a different slot for every day of the month, 1 through 31. And then we heat seal them in a container and a card. And then we label them for morning, evening, lunch, bedtime. And we expose them to 300-degree heat for about 3 seconds. And we only write, we don't write an expiration date beyond a year in those blister packs, because although they're protected from the outside, they aren't protected from the inside when we expose them to that heat. So, the short thing about this is don't worry about taking an expired medicine unless you're really, really sick. And the only reason is to be aware that it's not going to be as effective if it's expired, and it's going through the expiration date as it would have been if it had been in date. Is it better to take that expired medication while it's in date? Of course it is. But if it's on a Saturday or a Sunday or a holiday at a night and you can't get to a pharmacy without going to the nurse room and spending $1,000, would it be better to take the expired medication if it were me? Yes. I had a patient that actually was on a holiday week, and they had a prescription for an antibiotic that they had gotten from the pharmacy, and it was for the dog. And they called me at home and said, well, we have a prescription here that we've gotten for her dog when we had him a couple years ago, and he's passed away. Would it be okay over the weekend if I take that antibiotic? Well, I happen to have, at that point, I could access the pharmacy from my computer at home. I knew there was no sense of an allergic reaction. And condescend eventually, yes, it would be okay to give it to one of your children. They were of age. It wasn't a contraindication. And next time, don't let this flu or whatever it was that was going around get past Friday afternoon without calling your physician. So we took care of that in that situation, and everybody seemed to survive, so we know that can happen. We talked briefly in the last 2 months about a drug called Kratom, which is a over-the-counter drug that's supposed to have opiate-like qualities, and also be used to taper you off an opiate. It's available over the counter, and there has been some reports of it being contaminated with salmonella. So the FDA said it's the first time it is used as mandatory recall power for a preferred product after trying to get the company to voluntarily take the products back. They have been criticized for years by consumer advocates and some members of Congress who say it moves too slowly to recall potentially contaminated foods. And the reason they call it a food is it's a plant supplement sold to treat pain, to help using people stop using opiates or as a stimulant. The FDA recently, and we've talked about it on this radio show, has been warning against its use in general, and later issued a large voluntary recall notice after some samples were found to be contaminated with salmonella. And sickened 87 people. So as of April 2nd, the FDA and state partners have tested multiple Kratom products, and 26 different products tested positive for salmonella. So Tuesday's mandatory recall after it's climbed in a pharmaceutical switch, Bill calls herself as a consultant and packager of supplement products. The FDA took this action after the company failed to cooperate with the FDA's request to conduct a voluntary recall. So two samples of products made by them and sold in Oregon tested positive for salmonella. And the FDA is advising consumers to discard the products that are part of the mandatory recall, which include, but are not limited to, raw form organics, non-dicrotan, emerald green, raw form, organics, main, dicrotan, ivory white, and raw form organics, non-dicrotan, ruby red. That's based on imminent health risk posed by the contamination of this product and the refusal of the company to voluntarily act to protect its customers and issue a recall despite requests from the government. The government said we have serious concerns about the safety of any Kraton containing product, and we are pursuing those things separately. The federal government has moved to slow down the production. The Food Safety Modernization Act gave the recalls for the first time, but the agency has been aggressively preferring to persuade companies to recall voluntarily. So, also on Tuesday, the FDA said Houston-based Nutrazone Kraton products, because they had potential to be one of those items that we just mentioned, were also in the recall. Those were sold in Pennsylvania, Oklahoma, Washington, Missouri, Florida, Mississippi, and guess what? California. So, I know that is circulating in Flint County. I know that there are retailers that are selling this, and it is going to pose a health threat to you. So, be very careful about purchasing this product and thinking that you could system and have it function as a either a stimulant or a pain reliever or as a stimulant drug. So we'll see what happens to that. That came up really, really fast. Within 3 months, it was up and eligible, selling over. So, alright, Paul, you're a young man. If you were considering having more children, would you take the male birth control pill? A pill?
Yeah.
effective. But normally in men, hormones from the brain stimulate the production of testosterone and sperm. And the male pill works by blocking those brain hormones, which then lowers testosterone levels and expected to shut down sperm production. Now, the strange thing about this is it doesn't supposedly have any other side effects. So normally when you prohibit testosterone, you have side effects that are similar to being deficient in testosterone all the time. So what they really need to do is to block sperm production, and the key is to really bring down the concentrations to minute levels. Social media, women, women writing, let's let our men take one for the team for once. One man claimed he's not sure relying on us boys to take that is such a good idea. The next step is to study and see if the pill not only lowers testosterone, but also lowers sperm count enough to be an effective form of contraception. Although the pill won't be hitting the market anytime soon, so I'm sure I'll be out of the picture by the time it hits. But just remember, if you're taking that pill on the calendar and said, I took it today, for a young man, I don't know that it was possible enough not to do it on a daily basis, and, so I don't know how effective it would be when they start missing their days. Well, I think you'll find out. Other parts of their bodies using synthetic cannabinoids such as synthetic marijuana, according to Illinois Department of Health. If you thought marijuana was supposed to be pretty harmless, you're probably confused right now. Because the synthetic stuff is a whole different beast. Synthetic cannabinoids are unregulated, mind-altering chemicals that are either sprayed onto, dried, shredded plant materials so they can be smoked or sold as liquids meant to be vaporized and inhaled in e-cigarettes. Other devices, according to the Center for Disease Control, it's also known as Spice, K2, and Black Mamba. These drugs are anything but safe, and I'm thinking about the audience that I'm talking to right now, and probably this is completely foreign to you, but this fake weed or synthetic marijuana isn't going to react anything like marijuana. The medical complications from them are more severe and really hard to protect. And according to the CDC, a synthetic marijuana affects the same parts of the brain that THC does, which is the active chemical in marijuana. However, the synthetic stuff doesn't actually contain any THC. And instead contains a mix of chemicals very different from THC, which has different effects on your body. Some of those effects can be seizures, heart attacks, kidney failure, elevated blood pressure, vomiting, agitation can occur. The bleeding complications seen in the Illinois cases is new, and they're hearing about spontaneous nosebleeds, bleeding from the gums, people vomiting blood in the stool and urine, and an abnormal amount of menstrual bleeding. It can be absolutely life-threatening to people who are otherwise healthy. And we have a group of people in society right now that will take anything. We came across a person in a residential area a couple of days ago that was so out of it, I assume it was something off the street. There's some concern that drug linked with the Illinois cases are paired with a rat poison. What's unknown right now is, did someone take those products with the rat poison, or is it a novel action of cannabinoids we haven't seen before that's acting like rat poison? So a few patients have had testing and have tested positive for. So the bottom line is not to use those drugs even once. We have no idea what people will be exposed to if they buy one of those products. At least 80 to 100 new synthetic cannabinoids were identified just in 1 year. 80 to 100 synthetic cannabinoids. There are many, many chemicals in them. They're scary from a toxicity standpoint. They can be horribly devastating. So, you know, I never thought when I went to pharmacy school I would be talking about these kind of epidemics. I was talking to one of the sheriff's deputies the other day, and I was talking to him about how bad the epidemic is in Lake County. We got labeled as the worst county in the state of California for opiate deaths per 100,000 of any county in the state of California. Very, very serious, and that doesn't take into effect the methamphetamines and the black tar heroin and those kind of things. We have a lot of people that switch from prescription medications to those medications just to get loaded, just to get high. And they don't seem to think anything about being out of reality. So, we're going to take a break, and when we come back, we're going to talk about a lot of different things, and one of them is how your moles, are they normal or how to tell? Hi everybody, I don't know if you've realized it, but we are right in the middle of winter. My name is Bill Cody, owner of Northlake Medical Pharmacies. When the weather changes, it may not be as pleasant to drive to your pharmacy to pick up your prescriptions. We may have the solution for you. We now have free delivery to Kelsey-Dale, Cadillac Riviera West, Riviera Heights, Buckingham, and Stilton Lakeport, and Surrey, Nice, and Upper Lake. If you want your prescriptions delivered at no delivery cost to you, now is the time to transfer your prescriptions to Northlake Medical Pharmacies. Or bring in your new prescriptions and we'll take care of you. Whether the weather is cold and rainy or a beautiful day and you don't want to take that ride into the pharmacy, give us a call. Northlake Medical Pharmacies, with two locations to serve you, on Hill Road next to Center Lakeside Hospital, or outside the Brainerd Shops Mall, 347 Lakeport Boulevard. The Kelsey-Dale High School Class of 2018 Silver Grand Fundraiser Dinner Dance and Auction is Saturday, April 14th from 5 to 10 p.m. at Boutique Winery in Kelsey-Dale. Music will be provided by the Mark Preston Band and dinner provided by Lindy's Corny Catering. Tickets are available at Feral Gas in Lakeport, Dr. Vanavanian's office in Lakeport, and Klein Bookkeeping on Main Street in Kelsey-Dale. For more information, please call 49-3734. In the last decade, more than 400,000 people died on America's roadways. That's one person every 13 minutes. Roadway deaths strike the young or old at any time of the year, at any hour of the day or night. And it doesn't matter whether you drive a car on a highway, ride a motorcycle or bicycle on a country road, or simply take a walk near traffic. Everyone is at risk. Since 1969, members of the American Traffic Safety Services Association have worked diligently to make our nation's roadways safer by providing the majority of roadway safety features, including bright signs and pavement markings, guardrails, and crash cushions. These are just some of the roadway devices that save thousands of lives each day. Since most of our roadways were built in the 1950s, there's so much more work that needs to be done to reach the ultimate goal of zero deaths. Safer roads save lives. To learn how you can get involved, visit ETSSA.com. A public service message from the American Traffic Safety Services Association. We bring the community closer together, supporting business in every way. We're helping make the dreams come true. The Lake County Chamber of Commerce would like to recognize their Member of the Month, Hopkins Tax Consultants. John and Diane Tompkins have been serving Lake County since 1974, and have been a member of the Lake County Chamber of Commerce for 24 years. They provide services to many small businesses and individuals in Lake and Mendocino County. Their main office is located in Lucerne off Highway 20, and they also have a second satellite location in Lakeport at 576 Lakeport Boulevard. For more information, reach them at 274-1843.
Oh,
Princess, what did you have? She said, I had a great cheese sandwich with macaroni and cheese on top of it. Yeah, that's, you know, that's true. She said that was, that's like me having a chicken fried steak and morning for breakfast. I don't do that, but I do that about 3 times a year, but, this restaurant specializes in those kind of things, and I remember that, Australian restaurant, Outback is advertising the onion rings with a steak on top, and then fries on top of that, and then cheese on top of that. I can imagine what that would be to your waistline. First of all, let's get this mole thing out of the way. I'm not talking about an animal, I'm talking about a mark. For thousands of years we've had red meanings in the moles. There's one on your forehead, there's a birthmark, there's a, it's on the back of your neck, in 7th century women fashioned moles from taffeta or leather, decisive as moles have been, far from exceptional. Nearly every adult has some. They're more common than, they used to be, and they refer to them sometimes as beauty marks, but now as American culture moves away from one size fits all, there's encouraging signs that moles are getting a deal whenever a magazine cover or an ad campaign erases the smattering of moles. That makes us unique, so not every spot is a mole. You can tell what kind of a mark is on your skin, technically speaking. Excuse me. Moles are called nevi and can be flat, raised, flesh color, brown or black. Freckles too, groupings of melanocytes, but freckles often tend to come and go. Most people sport at least a few normal moles, even colored round, oval, and smaller. Simply having them doesn't make you more prone to skin cancer, but have more than five of the irregular kind, your risk of developing melanoma increases tenfold. So no matter what your situation, your best defense is a good offense. Wearing broad brim hats with an SPF of at least 30 daily. And on days you'll be outdoors, re-up every hour. A non-annoying strategy for when you're running around and don't feel like toting bottles of SPF in the morning, apply a base on your face. Like super good sunscreen, which is an SPF 40. Or the Neutrogena Hydro Boost Water Gel Lotion, which is a 50. Then keep a mask and handy for touch-ups and things. And healthy rules don't change. The way they look during pregnancy when estrogen levels are high for a period of time, your existing males can get darker, and that's because the estrogen increases melatonin production. But everyone should have a yearly skin cancer check with their dermatologist, but in addition, you should definitely look at your hormones every month. And it's the ABCD. We go over this every year. Asymmetry, that's healthy males are symmetrical, they're not irregular borders, they have one resembling the shape of Iceland, get it checked, if you don't know what Iceland looks like. Go look at a map. Border, the edges should be smooth and defined, not jagged. See, color, most males are single shade of brown, a black spot of multiple colors. Require a physician's check and the diameter. Anything larger than 6 millimeters, which is about the size of a pencil, erasure should be examined. So, elevation flat moles should stay flat. If one rises, see your dermatologist. So we're getting into the sunny part of the year shortly. Maybe after this week, or maybe after next week, or maybe after June, I don't know. But things out. I have an appointment on the 23rd of April to see my dermatologist, and I've been, since I saw her last time, I've been to Hawaii and to Tahiti. I don't normally have a problem with malignant type carcinogenic type moles, but anybody can. And sometimes you have to force a dermatologist to be a little bit aggressive with looking for that, to make sure that that isn't something that they don't need to look at many times. It's something that seems inactive and it really is. I get a product called the Pharmacist Letter every month, and it takes different parts of what's involved in medicine, and it relates certain situations about it. And this time, there was one on diabetes, and there was controversy brewing about how to individualize A1C goals. And if you're a type 2 diabetic, there is conflicting guidelines. Many of us were taught to aim for an A1C under 7%. And that's to reduce microvascular complications, retinopathy, neuropathy, every kind of nephropathy, which is of the kidney. And we don't think about the fact that lowering the A1C level doesn't seem to reduce macrovascular events, and that means heart attacks and strokes. And we've always been told, excuse me, that you need your A1C down so you don't stroke out or get a heart attack. Well, there isn't any evidence that that is going to decrease your risk of death. Plus, a one-size-fits-all approach for everybody, we know that doesn't work in diabetic diabetes. We know it doesn't work in obesity. We know it doesn't work in swap them almost any kind of individuals, and that's what I always tell people about. If this pill works on you or your sister, it may not work on your roommate, so don't be giving your medication to somebody else thinking that they're going to have the same effect you do. But over half of the type 2 patients are over 65 and have had diabetes for years, and have had many chronic conditions or diabetes complications. In those cases, it's okay to suggest to go under 7.5 to 8%, since the risk of hypoglycemia means low blood sugar often outweighs the microvascular benefit. So, we don't want to back off patients that are doing well, reducing their A1C. And if you don't know what an A1C level is, you haven't been seeing your physician in the last 5 years. When you have a blood glucose monitor, it measures your total glucose. An A1C measures the activity in your red blood cells for the past 60 to 90 days. In other words, when you are going into the doctor to have your blood tested, the signs